Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you have got plans only for our good, not for our destruction. Your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. These 3 days that you have given us, O Lord, we thank you in advance, O Lord, that you are going to teach us how to have a personal relationship with you, how to fellowship with you, and how to be attached to you at all times, so that your life that you came to give flows in abundance in our lives. Our thoughts are no longer captivated by the enemy. Oh Lord, speak to us through your word and help us to renew our mind. Please help us to be delivered from the spirit of doubts and unbelief, and teach us to trust your love, to believe in your love, and to experience that love in our everyday life. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah, please be seated. Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
So let's take Gospel of John 15 and verse number 1. This is going to be an amazing teaching, because I am also going to learn a lot from this teaching. Praise God.
Amen.
Gospel of John chapter 15 verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the wine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, is thrown away like a branch and withers. And the branch are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. I think of all the lines, 7 lines, we like the last one. What's the last one saying? If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Don't you like the last line?
Yes.
Yeah, I know that. And if you want that last line to manifest, then those 6 lines have to be in our lives. Praise God. So let's start with the first one, that Jesus is saying, I am the true vine and my Father is the vine dresser. So before we go to Jesus, we'll go to the Father and see what the Father is to say. Because the Father is the one who planted the vine. Because he is the gardener. The gardener makes the plan, and he is the one who will plant the vine. He is the one who will take care of the vine. He is the one who will supply the resources for the vine. And the vine is the one who will suck the nourishment that is needed for the vine. He will suck it and supply it to the branch. And the branch, after receiving the sap, will bring forth the fruit. So let's see what the Father has in his mind as the gardener. Because he is the gardener and we are the branches connected to the vine. So he definitely has some plans and purpose in our life. Do you agree? And he is a good gardener. He is not a bad gardener. He is a good gardener. He wants his branches to be bearing abundant fruit. Because the more the branch bears fruit, the more the Father is glorified. Praise God. So let's quickly jump to Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13 and verse number 6 to 9. Jesus is talking about the gardener. Luke chapter 13, verse 6 to 9. Jesus spoke also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree. Certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. And he came and sought fruit thereon and found none. Then he said to the dresser of the vine, "Behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it to the ground?" And he answering said unto him, "Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dunk it. And if it bear fruit, well, and if it not, then after that you shall cut it down." Praise the Lord. Now, this fig tree was on purpose planted in a vineyard. Fig trees are always planted in orchards, not in a vineyard. But this one was planted there on a purpose. Praise God. And what did the master come to see? The fig tree or the fruit? So when the gardener has planted, his main intention is what? The branch or the fruit on the branch? Praise God. So this fig tree, even though it was planted in the vineyard, the gardener, the master, wanted it to bear fruit. Praise God. So if the fig tree is surrounded by vine, creepers, will it stop its character and produce grapes now? A fig tree, will it start producing grapes? What is its character it will produce, right?
Yes.
So just because the vine is surrounding it does not mean that it has to change its character. Do you understand?
Yeah.
So just as this fig tree was planted especially in a vineyard, in the same way you and I on purpose have been planted by the Father in our homes, in our family, in marriage, in jobs, everywhere. And you are surrounded by vine creepers who really, really irritate you day and night. And when that irritation comes, the owner is saying, "Listen, you are a fig tree. I have put in you the power that is needed to produce what? Figs or grapes?
Figs.
So are you supposed to look at the grapes?
No.
Hello?
No.
So even though, how many times it has happened? Today my life is miserable because of that wine. Come on, you are the fig tree.
Yes.
Just because the vine is next to you doesn't mean you look at the vine and say, "I can't produce fruits." Said, no. We are supposed to produce the fruit. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now this fig tree refused to produce what? Fruit. Why did it refuse to produce the fruit? Because it did not like the environment around it. Is it possible it can happen in our life that God wants us to produce the fruit, But because of the environment, the atmosphere, the kiri 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 all around, we keep looking at the kiri 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 and we forget to produce the fruit, but we want to produce the leaves. Do you know what happens when a tree produces plenty of leaves? It looks beautiful. But leaves are always for the tree. They are never for others. Fruits are for others. So the very reason that we are the branch is that our life should be for others. But most of the time our lives are for? So we are producing fruits or leaves?
Leaves.
So what is the purpose of our life on earth? Produce fruits. So instead of producing fruits, what are we producing all this time?
Leaves.
And when the master comes and says, why no fruit? Because of the wine. Keep doing kiri 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 kiri. Is it possible? Oh, is it possible?
Yes.
Good. So now, from now on, is there any excuse of any environment that is negative around you should stop you from producing the fruit? Sister, are you from Goa?
Yes.
You must have definitely seen mango trees in Goa. Yeah. The mangoes are sweet in Goa. And they always come in the month of July, right?
April, May?
Not in July?
No.
April, May, so much of heat.
That's the
time. So much of heat.
Yeah.
And what about the dates?
Dates.
So much of heat.
Yeah.
Last time I took dates from Muscat, the fresh dates, which were about to get ripe, and I was so excited. I took quite a big number to Colombo, because from Colombo I'll go to India. And I'll enjoy in India. So I took it. I was there for 4 days. But the problem was, in Colombo it was raining 4 days. So what happened to my dates? They did not ripe only. They became all like this. Now the same dates in this hot sun are like this. The same dates in a rainy season have become started smelling. Now those fruits, when I thought why to give them so much of heat, I took them in a rainy climate, all got spoiled. So these dates, if there is rain, will it get spoiled?
Yes.
But are we comfortable in this heat outside?
No.
But in that uncomfort, the fruit is becoming sweet?
Yes.
So even in our life, when the environment is negative, if we turn to God, will our fruit become sweet?
Yes.
Yeah. But instead of turning to God, what are we turning to? Environment.
Yes.
We are focused on kir 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 kir. We are not focused on what Jesus said. So our fruit will be what? Kir kir kir.
Yes.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
So this fig tree was planted in the vineyard. For what purpose? It was planted in the sense that when this tree will bear fruit, the fruit will ripe. When the fruit is ripe, does it separate from the tree?
No.
When the baby is ripe, does it come from the womb?
Yes.
So God has designed it in such a way, when the fruit becomes ripe, it will automatically separate from the body. Now the fruit is for the body?
No.
No, for others. Correct? So this fruit ripes and falls down. Nobody is there to eat. What will happen? There are seeds in that tree, in that fruit. What will happen? It will produce another fig tree. So what was the purpose of this fig tree in that orchard? in that vineyard to bring forth fruit and reproduce more fig trees in that vineyard. So what is the purpose of your life? God has planted you in your family, in your marriage, in your job, in all kinds of critical negative atmosphere, so that you will produce the fruit and reproduce more fig trees in that area. Now why have I come to Kuwait? I've come to Kuwait with the fruit with seeds in it, so that more fig trees are produced in vineyard. So from now on, if I face any negative trial, will I get irritated or will I just pass the test? This morning I came to the immigration and I was in a hurry because I saw the queue is not there. I was the first passenger. So I saw the line is clear. In 2 minutes, 3 minutes I'll be out. So I came to the counter with full speed. The lady saw me at full speed and she took the paper and she said, your paper is not there. And she kept me waiting for 25 minutes there. Till another person came and checked, the paper was with that same lady. Correct? So, what kind of words should come out from your mouth? 25 minutes she made me wait. Is it easy to wait for 25 minutes? And that also she is saying, your papers are not here. You call up the people who has deposit the visa and all those. Now she is saying, Sister Sindhya is saying, I have deposited. She said, it's not come here, that's not my lookout. So, and I told Sister Cynthia when I got into the cab, today I passed the test with flying colors. I looked at her, I blessed her, I loved her, and I said, God, thank you that you have taught me how to produce fruit in unfavorable situations. Because normally our mind is set that Christianity means favorable situation. When you are in, you are with Jesus means what? All things should be in your favor. But actually speaking, when you look into the word of God, if you are with Jesus, all things are unfavorable. And in that unfavorable situations, you have to produce the fruit of obedience, produce the fruit of love, forgive the, produce the fruit of forgiveness. Praise God. And when we pass that test, the reward is awesome. So she was watching me. I was cool, giving her a smile, praying for her, and absolutely waiting. Praise God. So do we get opportunities like this? Negative opportunities you don't get? Let me pray for you. God will always answer my prayer. Hallelujah. You don't have any negative opportunities?
Yes.
So first thing remember, see, you must have heard this, no? You got a problem, come to Jesus, he'll solve your problem. Have you heard?
Yes.
Have you heard?
Yes.
Yeah, that's the problem. When you come to Jesus, your problems will increase. But when your problems will increase, he will not get you out of the problem. He will teach you to remain in the problem victorious. He will teach you to remain in the problem producing the fruits of love. And when he sees that the fruits are getting better and better, you are becoming better and better, your character is changing better and better, he is glorified. He is not glorified when everything is going on fine. He is glorified when everything is going bad. And in that bad situation, you are shining his light. You are shining his attitude. You are shining his and imitating him of his unconditional love, unconditional forgiveness. Now, he is glorified. He said, that's my baby. Hallelujah. But how? But when do we refuse to produce fruit? Because when anything unjust, irritation happens, we get offended. And when we are offended, will we be able to love anybody? Will we be able to produce the fruit? No. So, do we get such kind of opportunities every day?
No. Yes.
So now, will we grab those opportunities and say, God, now you are teaching me how I should become a Christian. I was telling the other day to one person, I said, all these years I've been teaching on faith. I've been teaching on grace. I've been teaching on power. I've been teaching on authority. From the last 5 months, I've been studying on a topic called storms, trials, unjust sufferings. And from the time I began to study that, I began to realize that if I say I'm a Christian, then this is my birthright and it has to be there in my life. And the best thing is, in the midst of all that, I learn to have an attitude of Christ. So I told this person, after 16 years, I'm trying to become a Christian now. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So what was the purpose of the fixing? Not to be like the wine, but to be like the... But to produce more fig trees, praise God. To create an orchard, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's the call for each one of us. We are living in the world of darkness. And we are the light shining in this world. And we, by speaking about Jesus through our actions, are drawing people to Christ. And when they also receive Christ, now what happens? We are creating more and more orchards instead of vineyards. Praise God.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Have you seen anybody from Bombay? Nobody from Bombay? I cannot give this example in Goa because it doesn't apply. Because, you know, in Goa, the mangoes are hanging out of the compound and they are so low, but nobody will pluck it. But in Bombay, by the time the mango becomes this size, the stones have gone up and the mango has come down. Are you following?
Yes.
So why does a person throw stones? Because he wants that
mango,
that fruit, praise God. And when he eats that fruit, it becomes his part, right?
Yes.
So in the same way, when we produce the fruit of love, that fruit is for whom? For me or for others?
Others.
So somebody has to come and eat the fruit. Yes, when he plucks the fruit, will it hurt the tree? Will it cause pain? Yes, because
pulling,
okay, and eating the fruit, okay. But once that person starts eating the fruit, is he going to enjoy the fruit?
Yes.
When a person enjoys the fruit of God, of Jesus in us, that's the time the person begins to change. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We will say, Jesus is my Lord, but we give them all bitter mangoes to eat. Now will they change or they'll take the mango and throw on you? Hello. So bitter mangoes, your life will become more bitter. Sweet mangoes, life will become sweet all around you. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Then this fig tree was supposed to produce the seed in the fruit. And only when this fig tree would lose the seed, that seed would go and produce more fig trees. So what is the gardener's main intention? To have the branch connected to the vine? Or is that the branch will produce the fruit with the seed in it, so that through you, hundreds, thousands, millions of people's life can be changed. So the more and more you produce the fruit of love in your life, in you is the seed of love. And this seed, when it is loosed in other people's life, now what happens? Somebody said, I brought somebody, I want that person to talk. And I said, let that person listen to the word of God, then I will talk. Now, what about that person who is brought? That person is wanting another vineyard, orchard. So, when the word of God touches my life, and the other person looks at my life and says, hey, how come so much beautiful your life has become? Your problems are still the same, but I can still see peace in you. I can see a smile on you. I can see the strength in you. I can see the patience in you. I can see the joy and kindness and gentleness in you. How can you be so different in the midst of all this pressure? You want to know? Come, I'll teach you. And you bring that person to a Bible class. Now what did you do? That person is attracted to you because of your fruit. If a person is attracted to you because of the look, you are in trouble. But if a person is attracted to you because of the fruit, that means that person wants to become holy and good and imitate Christ. So do we attract people with a fruit or with a look? Hello. The world attracts people with what? Look of
look
of fruit.
Look.
But if you are a branch of the vine, you will attract people with what?
Fruit.
Praise God. Hallelujah. How do I look today? Hallelujah. Thank God. Somebody said something, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So it's extremely important, if your environment is not favorable, lose the fruit of God. And watch and see. That fruit has got seeds. Seeds of eternal life. Seeds of salvation. Seeds of love. Seeds of kindness and forgiveness. And these seeds are very, very powerful. They will surely bring in a beautiful future. Hallelujah.
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 Now, when this happens, the fruit a person tastes, you are more interested in that person's enjoying your fruit. You are not more focused on changing that person's life, but you are now more focused on producing the fruit. Normally, which one are we more interested in? Producing the fruit or changing the person?
Changing the person.
You will never be able to change. Because in this world, nobody can change anybody.
Yes.
But only one thing can be changed. Our fruits can change. So when our fruit changes, automatically everything will change. But our main focus is what? Everybody changes. Nothing is wrong with me. Everybody is right. Everything is wrong with everybody else. You start saying, nothing is wrong with anybody. Everything is wrong with me. And Lord, I want to change. Once a person gets that attitude, I need to change. I need to change. Okay, that person is reacting to me this way. Lord, how do you want me to change for him, for her? Teach me. And now when I begin to change, I will begin to bear fruits. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So, do we have opportunities every day to produce the fruit?
Yes.
So, what's the purpose of the gardener? Why do you think you are planted in a particular relationship? Why are you planted in that family? Why not in some other country? It is a specific purpose and plan of the gardener. He says, even my hair cannot fall without his permission. If the hair has fallen, then he has allowed it to fall because he knows something great, something special, something good and something much better is waiting for me. Did he allow Joseph to be sold as a slave?
Yes.
Come on. Could he avoid that?
No,
if God wanted, he could have avoided that?
Yes.
Easily. Now, when the master's wife tried to seduce him, could the Lord avoid that as well?
Yes.
But did God allow that? God allowed that to happen in Joseph's life. Did he get unjustly accused? Falsely accused?
Yes.
Was he thrown into the prison?
Yes.
Could God save him from the prison?
Yes.
But did God allow that?
Yes.
He said, okay, go into the prison. But in all these things, did God still have a plan?
Yes.
But with the eyes, did it look extremely negative?
Yes.
Come on, did it look negative?
Yes.
Yes. But in the eyes of God, was it negative?
No. It was a great plan.
Now in the prison, everybody is a prisoner, but Joseph decides to be a servant there. Was that his job? No. Was he producing the fruit?
Yes.
Come on, was he producing the fruit?
Yes.
Yes. Now when the two prisoners were sad, did they consult him? Yes. Why did they consult him? Because of his fruit. Did he give them the solution? Yes. Did they remember him after that? No. Did he curse them?
No.
No. Did God allow them to forget him?
Yes.
Now all these negative situations happened, but did Joseph still produce figs in the vineyard?
Yes.
Praise God. So when he was still in the prison, after 2 years, what happened? One of the prisoners remembered and told the king, King, there's one man who can solve your problem. Praise God. And that was the time Joseph was brought before the king. Now, did Joseph use his gift? How could he use his gift? Because he was constant fellowship with God. Am I in constant fellowship with God? Or am I constantly telling God to solve my problem? How would you feel? There's somebody who comes and meets you, your friend, and always says, give me 1,000 KD, you know. Give me 500 KD, you know. Give me 100 KD, you know. Doesn't talk about anything else. Every time, hi, good morning, give me KD. Will you like that friendship?
No.
Another one never says anything. Only talks and talks and enjoys all your fellowship and all. And you see that that person is having no problem, having some issues. Before he can ask, won't you go and solve his problem? Come on. Now which category are we in? Gimme? Or talk? That's the problem. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
So from now on, gimme close.
Yes.
Talk. You know, the Lord wants us, even if you don't talk, just sit with him and say, God, I don't know what to talk. I just want to sit with you, leaving everything aside. I want to be with you. He's still happy. And when you do that, you begin to hear his voice. You begin to hear his heart. And that's what happened to Joseph. That's why he could interpret the dream. Now with that one seed, did he save his household?
Yes.
Did he save the people in Egypt?
Yes.
Yeah. So in the same way, when we fellowship with God, and in the midst of, especially in the midst of negative things that are happening around us, are we still focused on God, or the negative things are talking to us?
Negative.
And when those negative things are talking to us, are we fellowshipping with God or the negative things?
Negative.
Now whose fruits are you producing?
Negative.
Can you ask your neighbor, whose fruit are you producing? Huh?
Negative.
So what are you supposed to create, vineyard or orchard?
Orchard.
So what are you supposed to create? Orchard, what are we creating? Worries. So what are you creating? Vineyard? Orchards?
Vineyard.
But do we have the capacity to create an orchard?
Yes.
But are we using that capacity?
No.
So I imagine how painful it will be for the gardener who has given you the capacity, who has done everything and saying, listen, your character is to produce the figs, not grapes. But instead of producing the good fruit, we are producing jealousy, insecurity, greed, lust, selfishness, all kinds of sinful things. Praise God.
Thanks, God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
So this fig tree enjoyed all the nourishment sent by the gardener. Correct? Hello?
Yes.
But was he producing anything good for the kingdom?
No.
So supposing today we are all are going to die, supposing, and we are all standing in a queue, and God has to ask each one, okay, tell me, what did you do on planet Earth? How many orchards, how many fig trees have you created? How many people did you bring into the kingdom? So did you bear any fruit? Yes, Lord, I bore 3 fruit. 2 boys, 1 girl. Hello. What would be answer? It's not late. It's not late. What would be answer? Is our top priority to produce the fruit or our top priority is the blessing? Now, let's be honest here. Which one are we focused more on? That's why this is not coming. Blessings are always proportionate to the fruit. The more the fruit you produce, the more the blessings will show up. You don't even have to pray. It's by default. But the devil will put in our mind, where are we more attracted, fruits or blessings?
Blessings.
Because fruits you have to labor. Blessings come gift. So which one is more enjoying? Blessing is for you. Correct?
Yes.
That blessing is also not for you. It is also to be distributed. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do you want to go now?
Yes.
No, the topic is not good, no?
No.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
3 years of nourishment given to this fig tree. Full nourishment. Did it produce any fruit? He ate everything and produced what? Leaves. Leaves are always for the tree. Fruits are for others. So when the tree produces fruit, it becomes weak. Do you know that? Because the sap used to produce the fruit is very, very high. So the tree has to use the sap not for itself, but for the fruit, which is not for him. Now, if you got 10 KD, how much KD you want to keep for others?
Not even 1 KD.
So what are you producing? Leaves or fruit?
Leaves.
Are you following what I'm saying?
Yes.
Thank God I can explain better the Bible through the KDs. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then you begin to wonder, Lord, I'm praying so much, but nothing is happening. You're praying so much, but Baba, how can I give you more? Because all that I'm depositing in your account is going in your stomach. Only leaves. Can you touch your neighbor and say, can you feel my leaves? Hallelujah. Don't get irritated, okay? It's honest. This is how it is. Our life is right.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. See, listen. Many of us have failed because we were ignorant. Even I was ignorant. When I got into the Bible and I began to realize that the very focus of the gardener is that I produce the fruit. The top priority of the gardener is that I produce the fruit. And my top priority in those days was blessing. So there was a mismatch. So I had to change my thinking from blessing to fruit. Life began to change. Praise God. That's all. So we are all learning, including me. I told you I'm learning. Praise God. Hallelujah. So this gardener for 3 years did not see fruit. The first 2 years, did he say anything?
No.
He allowed. How many years has father allowed us? Hello? To produce the leaves. Now he says, I have given you too much of nourishment. He tells the gardener, cut off the tree. Do we need to reach that cutoff system or do we need to change before that?
He changed before that.
I got changed when it was cutoff system. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But in that cutoff system, the gardener said, give me one more chance. And in that one more chance, he said, you better repent, better change your life. Otherwise, you will be cut off, you will be dried up and thrown into the fire. Praise God. So 16 years back, I came to my senses. So do we also want to go for another some few years and then find one day withered? No, praise God. So can we just close eyes for a moment and ask ourselves, is God looking into my heart, into my life and asking me, all that I've blessed you with, how are you using it? Does God see me a person full of leaves but no fruit? Because when a plant produces fruit, the plant becomes more and more a disciple of Jesus. That means an extreme imitator of Christ. That means a person who renews his mind in total obedience to God's word, even if it's painful, even if it's uncomfortable. The person's top priority is to love. And the more and more the person becomes a disciple with love. Now we cannot see others suffering and out of him comes evangelizing. How do I evangelize Jesus to others? Am I a person who comes here to receive the word and uses the word, the nourishment of the word, only for my benefits? Or do I come here to receive the word and then I go there with the fruit that I've produced through the word to share with others? But here in this parable we find Jesus the intercessor. Jesus loves you, my friend. And it is Jesus that saved that tree from being cut off by saying that you would do two things in this tree to make it fruitful. One, dig it. And two, dunk it. We have been unproductive in our life. And to dig it, Jesus will have to come and break up the ground, the areas where we have been selfish, where we have been sinful. He will come and break those things in our life. It is going to be a painful process. It's going to be an uncomfortable process. And we will not even like this process. But this process is a must. And second thing, he will do it that he will dunk it. The process of fertilizing the tree. The dung will stink. And that's why you find in your life, in different relationships, there are some relationships that are so painful that it actually stinks. But in those very relationships, God is going to take the test of the word that we have learned. The word that is giving us the wisdom. You might say, God, it's so painful. God, it's stinking. It's smelling. It's so uncomfortable, Lord. But the Lord is saying to each one of us, it is a must. It is a must because it is for our own good. In the past, we have given up. In the past, we have run away from the test. In the past, we have failed to do what the word says. And the word that was planted in our heart was lost. Satan took away that seed out of our heart. And so, having the seed gone, the life was gone. The test was over. We never overcame the test. But today the Lord is saying to each one of us, in the midst of all this negative, if we make a strong commitment and a strong decision to be the doer of the word, to obey the word, then that obedience will produce the fruit. Jesus is with us to strengthen us, to nourish us, to teach us, to lead us, to guide us, to show us His ways. But if we still refuse to apply His ways in our life, we might find ourselves cut off. Jesus is still giving us an answer. There are times when people have been cut off, but the roots are still alive. There's still a chance. There's still a hope. As long as it was not uprooted, the fig tree still has the chance, an opportunity to once again grow and produce the fruit. So today let us make this firm commitment to the Lord, to the gardener, that Lord, I'm going to use your word, which is an incorruptible seed, every day of my life. My thoughts, my words, my deeds will imitate your word, so that I no longer produce the seeds and the fruits of the kingdom of darkness. It's your seed, Lord, that transforms my life. It's your seed, Lord, that blesses me and brings about a change in me. And Lord, I want to even dedicate my life to you, that all these seeds that you have planted in my heart, that has brought a change in my life. From now on, I will not keep for myself, but share it with others so that they too become a fruit-bearing tree. Lord, the more and more we use your seed, the word, in our life, the more and more we are able to experience your goodness. And that's what the psalmist says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Lord, you are so good that your goodness cannot be kept with ourselves, but shared in this decaying and dying world, so that more and more people are transformed. Father, thank you for the seeds that you have given us, that with these seeds, we too will spread these seeds to others and so bring in our great harvest. Now I understand, O Lord, by the fruits that I bear, souls will be saved, burdens will be removed, yokes of the devil shall be destroyed, and lives will be changed. And in all this, Father, you are the one who receives the glory, and we are the ones who reap the benefits. Thank you, Father, for showing us your intention for each one of us. We thank you and we praise you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
So are we supposed to produce now?
Yes.
So are we by mistake? Are we a mistake on this planet Earth?
No.
Might be, parents might say, but that's the lie. The Father has purposely planted us on a mission. 16 years back, I did not know this would be such a beautiful future of my life. But when I believed and began to travel one day at a time, 16 years later on, when I look behind, it's been so awesome. If somebody has to ask me the question, have you led anybody to Christ whose lives have changed? I can say lakhs of people. So what am I doing every day? Producing the fruit. And that fruit, when people taste, they say, we want more. You know, that fruit comes from the sap of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Imagine thousands and thousands and thousands of people whose lives are waiting to be changed, and all through you. But our own selfishness will destroy their lives. For example, I could have been taking a holiday today and stayed at home, but you wouldn't have received the message. People who are watching now live, they wouldn't have received the message. So my comfort would make somebody uncomfortable, but my uncomfort can make others comfortable. So am I going to see about me? Or am I going to see about others? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Praise
so,
the Lord.
I am the true wine and my Father is the wine dresser. So, this is clear, absolutely clear,
yes,
that you are on purpose planted in an atmosphere which is negative. It's not meant to kill you. It's meant for you to produce the fruit. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Now our way of thinking has changed.
Yes.
But remember the last time I shared about mother swimming?
Yes.
My brother taught me swimming.
Yes.
He taught me by throwing me into the deep waters.
Yes.
And I struggled and struggled and struggled.
Yes.
But praise God, I learned to swim.
Yes.
Now, if somebody has to throw me in the water, will I be scared?
No.
Why not? Because I've learned to overcome that water. In the same way, We have got different kinds of trials in life. And in all those trials, God is the one who will teach us to swim. And once you learn to swim on those trials cannot kill you anymore. And now that you learn to swim in those trials, you can come and teach others who are going through the same trials, those who are getting drowned. Hey, listen, I want to teach you. Jesus taught me how to swim. So let me come and teach you. Now what are you doing? Teaching others how to swim in their trials. So has your trial become a blessing or has it become a curse?
Yes.
But all throughout our life, we have been taught, when trouble comes, avoid, run, but don't face it. You know, what surprised me was in the book of Acts, nowhere you find the early Christians ever praying to God, God, get me out of this trial. Nowhere. They would be praying, God, give us the strength to go through this trial victorious. Correct? But now what is happening? What is our prayer? Our prayer is all about, God, get me out of this trial. Don't see to it that I'm very comfortable. Don't do anything that will make me uncomfortable. When we are uncomfortable, that's where we learn a lot. Christian life is all about learning. Learning God's ways. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
So every branch, verse 2, every branch in me that bear not fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. So very important for producing the fruit is, you must first have the seed. And the seed is the word of God. And this word of God needs to be memorized. This word of God needs to be
memorized.
Because, you know, if the word of God is a seed, and if it's not in my heart, then that seed cannot give me the fruit. It cannot sprout. It cannot bring that tree, because the seed is not there. So memorizing means storing that seed in your heart, that even if you don't open the Bible, you can remember it. And more than remembering it, very important is, that seed needs to talk to you. Okay, let me put it this way. You went to the doctor and the doctor gave you a bad report. How many times did the doctor give you a bad report?
Once.
How many times did he tell you got a problem?
Once.
How many times will he come and talk to you, the doctor? Once. Now you are coming back home. Is the doctor coming with you?
No.
But can you remember his words?
Yes.
Hello, can you remember his words?
Yes.
Why are you able to remember his words? Because those words have gone deep down in your heart. And without your knowledge, they have already started growing. And the more and more you are remembering, what are you doing? Watering. The more you water, the more it grows. Faster it grows. After 1 week, what will happen? Crying. Worrying, blood pressure shot up, health gone for a toss. Why? The process is good, but the wrong seeds. You take the same process with God's word and do it the same way. Amazing results. Have you ever heard people say, I've got a weak memory?
Yes.
Especially the ladies will say, I got a weak memory. But do they have weak memory what the mother-in-law said to her? Joe, Gary boy, Gavin, we and this brother, we are the only boys. All are ladies. So, no sound coming. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do we have a weak memory when it comes to our problems?
Powerful.
So write down these points why I should memorize the word of God. What are the benefits? Write down. Memorizing scriptures. Makes meditation possible. At times, when I can't be reading the Bible, and meditation is the pathway of deeper understanding. And meditation is the pathway of deeper understanding. Second one. Memorizing scriptures strengthens my faith. Because faith comes by hearing. Okay, I'll repeat again. Memorizing scripture strengthens my faith. Because faith comes by hearing. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And that happens when I'm hearing the word in my head. Third one?
Hearing the word?
In my head. I'll explain to you. Memorizing scriptures. Shape the way I view the world. Memorizing scriptures shape the way I view the world by conforming my mind to God's viewpoint. Next one, memorizing scripture makes God's word more readily accessible for overcoming temptation to sin, because God's warnings and promises because God's warnings and promises are the way. Are the way we conquer. Are the way we conquer the deceitful promises of sin. The deceitful promises of sin. Next one. Memorizing scriptures is my mind. Memorizing scriptures guards my mind by making it easier to detect error. Guides my mind by making it easier to detect error and the world is filled with error and the world is filled with error. Since the God of this world is a liar. Since the God of this world is a liar. Memorizing scripture. Next one. Memorizing scripture enables me to hit the devil. Memorizing scripture enables me to hit the devil in the face. Memorizing scripture enables to hit the devil in the face with a force he cannot resist. With a force he cannot resist. And so protect myself and my family. And so protect myself. And so protect myself and my family from his assault. Protect myself and my family from his assault. Memorizing scriptures provides the strongest and sweetest. Memorizing scriptures provides the strongest and sweetest words. Memorizing scriptures provide the strongest and sweetest words for ministering to others in need. For ministering to others in need. Last one. Memorizing scriptures provides the matrix for fellowship with Jesus. Provides the matrix for fellowship with Jesus because he talks to me through his word. Because he talks to me through his words and I talk to him in prayer.
Talks to me
through his word and I talk to him in prayer.